Hello everyone, welcome to Critical Engine Factors. Hope that you are having a good day and enjoying your multi-engine training so far. As we jump into it, brief little reminder on what the critical engine is. The critical engine is the engine whose failure has the most adverse effect on control and performance. Remember, this applies to what is known as a conventional twin, or an aircraft whose propellers both rotate in the same direction. Counter-rotating twins don't experience these forces in the same way because both propellers are moving in opposite directions. That keeps the thrust lines close to the fuselage versus the factors we'll discuss for a conventional twin. That'll all make a little more sense as we get into it, but keep in mind, again, critical engine is for the conventional twins. We'll be assuming that our left engine is critical, so that means that both propellers are going to be rotating clockwise when viewed from the cockpit. We'll work through each of our four factors and discuss what about each of these factors makes the left engine critical. Have a fancy acronym here, it's called PAST. And we'll use PAST to work through each of the four critical engine factors that we have. All right, so we'll start with the first one here. It's P factor. That is a term that should be very familiar by this point in your training, as it's one of the big left turning tendencies that we look at throughout private training, commercial training, and maneuvers, all that. As always, P factor is going to be a yaw force. So it's going to have an impact on the direction that the plane's nose turns. All right. So what about P factor makes the left engine critical? You remember that especially at high angles of attack, the right-hand descending blade of a propeller is going to have a greater angle of attack than the left-hand ascending blade of the propeller. This means that that right-hand ascending blade generates more thrust than the left-hand ascending blade. All right. Usually, when we have a single-engine aircraft, this means that we have a left-turning tendency, right, that yaws the nose toward the left. In the multi-engine aircraft, that also means that we have our first semblance of a critical engine. So let's draw what that looks like, right? We have two engines here. Remember that the right-hand descending blade has a greater angle of attack. Since it generates more thrust, that means, as I can draw out, that the right-hand propeller blade has a greater thrust line than the left-hand propeller blade, right? It's generating more thrust. Make note of the difference between these two engines, right, in this term. If we draw out what this looks like, we can see that the thrust line on the right, the higher thrust line, has a longer arm to the fuselage than the left engine, right? So the greater, higher thrust line, in other words, on the left-hand engine, it's closer to the center line of the fuselage, to that longitudinal axis, than the higher thrust line on the right engine. When we went over weight and balance earlier, remember that the longer an arm is, the more force that arm has on a surface. That's why, for example, that the aircraft is more stable with a forward CG. When you move those controls with the 4CG, the longer arm has a greater impact on the empennage, on the tail, than an FCG. Same thing here. If we have a longer arm between the rightmost higher thrust line on the right engine, that thrust line is going to have more force on the center line of the airframe and on the airframe as a whole than the left engine. So if we lose that right engine, the plane's going to stay relatively pretty stable because the higher thrust line, again, it's closer to the center line of the aircraft. If we lose that left engine, now with the higher arm, the yawing and rolling force that an aircraft experiences with a dead engine is going to be higher, right? More force, more yawing and rolling impact. So, if we get rid of this for a moment, it's going to be harder to control the aircraft when the right engine is still operating, the left engine fails, than when the right engine is the one that fails. So that greater adverse effect on control and performance is going to make the left engine critical. Right? So that's P factor. Look as well at accelerated slipstream. Accelerated slip, I'll just kind of write, I'll abbreviate that term a little bit. This is a rolling motion towards the dead engine. I'll switch colors briefly to a black marker since this is it's a little fainter, so it's kind of easier to distinguish what is what. Remember that lift is generated by two things, angle of attack, and important for this discussion, velocity. So the faster that the air is moving over the wings, the more lift they create. When air is flowing through the propeller, it accelerates, right? So when we kind of have our normal airflow to either side of the propeller, as that air flows through the propeller, it's kind of spun up a bit by the movement of the prop and it accelerates. So it's moving faster behind the engine, behind the propeller, if you want to be precise, than it is on either side of the wing. All right? The reason that the left engine is critical is predicated on the same movement arm that we discussed for P factor, right? So we can draw back in the thrust vectors on the propeller for the left engine, all right? So just as with the right, the thrust vector on the right-hand side of the prop is greater, more thrust, right? That means that if, it might be hard to see, but the air moving through the propeller accelerates more on the right-hand side of the prop than it does on the left-hand side for the same reason, right? The air exerts more, or the propeller exerts more force on the air on the right-hand descending blade. Remember, it's taking the bigger bite, exerting a greater force than it does on the left, accelerating the air faster. Same thing with that longer movement arm. If you suddenly lose this engine and you lose the lift being created by the propeller accelerating that airflow, now, just like as you have in a normal turn, you have more faster airflow moving over that right engine or the right wing, which is going to roll the plane towards that left side, towards the dead engine. With a longer movement arm on the right hand side between that right hand propeller blade and the fuselage, that rolling force is going to be greater and it's going to have more of an impact than the left-hand side where that arm is shorter. So if you lose the right engine, there's more of a rolling force towards the left than if you lose the left engine and roll towards the right, again, due to that longer movement arm. The third critical engine factor has less to do with what the right engine does and what the right engine doesn't do. Right? This is spiraling slipstream. All right, so when air moves through that propeller, remember that it spirals a little bit and deviates behind the aircraft and to the right. All right? Take note. That left engine's slipstream, I didn't draw the diagram the best, but the idea here is that the left engine slipstream will eventually encounter the rudder. If you lose that right engine, remember the plane wants to yaw and roll to the right. With the spiraling slipstream from the left engine striking the rudder, the tail is going to move to the right. That's going to yaw the plane left, and it's going to counteract some of the yawing and rolling forces that you experience due to the dead engine, right? So you're getting a little bit of natural assistance from the slipstream off the left engine if that right engine fails. If the left engine fails, the right engine isn't doing anything wrong here. It's just that this slipstream is diverging completely away from that tail. So it's not going to strike the rudder, it's not going to strike the vertical stabilizer, and it's going to have no effect whatsoever on the controllability. So again, it's not about what that engine does, it's about what the slipstream doesn't do that causes the failure of the left engine to have a greater adverse impact on control and performance, and it's going to make that left engine critical. Our last force is torque. And I should mention, by the way, spiraling slipstream, that's a yaw. That's a yawing impact. Our last force is torque. This is a roll force. Remember, these propellers, we're assuming, are both rotating to the right. So we're going to have right-hand rolling impacts. Remember, again, this is something that we learn in kind of private training and on. Due to Newton's third law, thanks to the right-hand rolling forces, or the right-hand rotation force, I think is maybe a better way of phrasing it, due to the right-hand rotation force of the propeller, of the crankshaft, of the whole engine body, there has to be an equal opposite reaction that rolls the plane to the left, right? So just as we have that right-hand force from the engine spinning right, there's also an equal and opposite reaction that will roll the plane back to the left, right? If the right engine fails, imagine for a second the right engine fails, again, the plane is going to want to yaw and roll to the right. This torque force on the left engine is going to bring the plane back left. So there's going to be kind of a counterbalance that won't eliminate, but will help to offset the drag and the yaw and roll that you feel towards the right engine. If the left engine fails, you already have a yaw and roll to the left. Remember these first three things, right? You're already yawing and rolling towards that engine. But now the torque effect is going to exacerbate that roll, right? Because it's already naturally rolling the plane left. So now you're getting an additional force that's causing the plane to diverge further and further and further away from its initial flight path. That is going to limit the amount of rudder you can use to counteract the failure, because you need to use more rudder, not only to keep the plane stable and level, maintain control, but you're also counteracting extra torque force, which is going to exacerbate all of the forces that you already feel, which is why, again, the failure of the left engine is more adverse for control and performance, because you're no longer getting help counteracting the forces toward the right. Dead engine, you're instead having the left engine or the forces toward a dead left engine pulling the plane further and further and further away from stable flight. So there's more of an adverse effect on control and performance. I hope you found this helpful. I hope you found it informative. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.